Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute warmly welcomes you to a world-class educational campus that showcases excellent infrastructure facilities, housing various departments in diverse fields of study. Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute warmly welcomes you to a world-class educational campus that showcases excellent infrastructure facilities, housing various departments in diverse fields of study.
Educational and Research Institute, Madurai, Chennai. Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute, Madurai, Chennai.
And there is great gathering of great minds. It's indeed a matter of great honor to welcome you all for this webinar on the topic Advanced Pulmonary Function Test. It's happy that our Faculty of Allied Health Sciences is successfully organizing a series of webinar, and this is the fourth webinar organized. At this moment, I take this as an opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to our Founder Chancellor, through Dr. A.C. Shanmugam Sir, our Honorable President, Engineer A.C.S. Arun Kumar Sir, and our Honorable Secretary, Thiru A. Ravikumar Sir. I also extend my gratitude to our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Geeta Lakshmi Ma'am, and our Registrar, Dr. Payanivel Sir. It's my pleasure to welcome our Medical Director, Dr. Shanawas Khan Sir, who provides a constant support in all our efforts. And now I take this as an opportunity to express my hearty welcome to the guest speaker of the day, Dr. Jacqueline Moses, Interventional Pulmonologist, Associate Professor of our Medical College, who has consented for this webinar. Welcome, sir. I also extend my warm welcome to all the faculty members and students for their enthusiastic participation. I am sure that you will all feel enriched with knowledge after completion of this event. I welcome you all once again and hope that you will all have a great time ahead. Welcome you all.
Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce our guest chief guest, Dr. Jacqueline Moses, MD Pulmonology. Sir done his undergraduate and postgraduate in Pondicherry Institute of Medical Sciences. After completing his degree, he worked in Apollo Hospital. At the year of 2014, Sir joined in our prestigious institution, ACS Medical College and Hospital, as assistant professor and took over the in charge for medical ICU and department of TV and chest. At 2019, Sir has been promoted as Associate Professor. Sir is a member of RNTCP and the Revised National Tuberculosis Control Program and Indian Chest Society. Sir also done his valuable paper and poster presentation regarding lung transplantation in United Kingdom and received honorary awards. Sir also got the opportunity to assist the lung transplantation procedure in UK. Sir also received honorary awards in critical care program and bridging nutritional support in hospitals. Sir is an expert in interventional procedures like bronchoscopy, thoracoscopy, intercostal drainage, pleural and ascitic tapping, medial thoracocentesis, airway breathing circulation management, tracheostomy, and insertion of intertubular vein, subclavian, femoral and arterial line, suprapubic catheter line insertion, and elective emergency intubation. Sir fathers is a Dr. Ruben Moses, is an experienced general physician for 40 years and owns a nursing home in Virgambakkam, Chennai. We welcome you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good afternoon to everybody. Thank you for this honor. I thank our Founder Chancellor, our President, our Secretary, and our Vice Chancellor for giving us this opportunity to conduct this webinar. Today's topic is advanced PFTs. We thought, being Allied Health Sciences, you know, students of respiratory therapy, physician assistants should know what a pulmonary function test is, how it is done, and you know, how it is interpreted, and what are the uses of doing a pulmonary function test. So that it is, you know, your knowledge base is much better compared to other students. Now, I'll go into the topic. One second. Right. Can everybody see my slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. So we're going on into the topic, pulmonary function testing, the advanced. What are the various methods we use to assess the lung function tests? Lung function in a patient is basically the common and the most available one across the country is spirometry. And then also we have advanced pulmonary function tests such as lung volumes, diffusion capacities, or known as DLCO. These are advanced PFTs, not very commonly available. They're very rare to come by, and wherever it is available, it is used for monitoring and assessing the progression of various lung pathologies. There are also other supplementary scans and supplementary tests that we can do to indirectly assess the lung function, such as the ventilation perfusion scan, arterial blood gas analysis, your cardiopulmonary exercise testing, and as well as 6-minute walk test. But in today's topic, I'm going to go in detail about spirometry and lung volume study and diffusion capacity, because these three are very important in assessing the lung function. Let's start with spirometry. How do you interpret, how do you do the test, and how do you report the test? These three are most important in doing the spirometry test for a patient. Now, what are the various indications why we will do a spirometry for a patient? We want to assess the respiratory symptoms and signs. Say a patient comes with cough, cold, fever, breathlessness, basically all the classical respiratory symptoms. You want to assess what is the cause of all these problems, what is happening to his lungs. Then you have, for evaluating his respiratory symptoms and signs that you are assessed, you do a spirometry. The next most thing is assisting in your diagnostic process. Say you make a clinical diagnosis of bronchial asthma.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. Your slide is not visible.
Oh, it is sharing only, ma'am.
The slide is not visible, and just make it a full screen, sir.
One second, ma'am. You can see my slide now, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Okay, ma'am, I'm going to go into slideshow. One second. You can still see my slides?
No, sir.
Okay. So I think the moment we go in, now you can see it.
Yes.
Okay, I think I'll continue like this itself, ma'am, because the moment we go into slideshow, it's disappearing. You can all see my slides, ma'am.
Yeah, okay.
Right, I'll continue like this, ma'am. There's some technical glitch here. Anyway, so I will carry on with the topic. So as I said, you make a clinical diagnosis of bronchial asthma. You want to have an assist in making your diagnosis, confirming your diagnosis. You want to do a pulmonary function test to see if there is airway obstruction, which is evident by doing spirometry. The next is to monitor an activity of a disease. Now, why do you monitor an activity of a disease? Now, if a patient comes to you with, say, COPD or an asthma or a bronchiectasis, positive ocular sequelae, anything, any airway pathology, you are managing the patient with optimal medical therapy. You are putting all the necessary medications. You are, you know, optimize the medical care of the patient. He comes to you for follow-up after 2 months, 3 months, 6 months. You want to assess if his lung function is getting better, if his disease progression is slowing down, if his disease is coming under control. For monitoring the activity of the disease, we use spirometry. But as I said, you can use this also for responsive therapy. After giving the drug, to see if there is good response and the patient's general condition is improving. Then finally, we also use it for prognostication. That is, if the lung function is very poor and a patient with COPD who has already, say, pulmonary hypertension, congestive cardiac failure, all the other complications that can arise out of COPD, then you can prognosticate with a poor lung function and say that this patient has a poor chance of survival. He has a high chance of morbidity and mortality. The most common necessity for using spirometry is environmental and occupational hazards. Now, there are so many employees who work in silica dust, asbestos dust, sawdust, hay dust. these kind of employees tend to have deposition of these toxic stimuli, toxic chemicals into their lungs. As they get deposited in your lungs lose their functional capacity. To assess the functional capacity of the lung, they do pyrometries. So patients who, employees who work in factories which are dealing with occupational smoke and occupational dust, they have a regular annual screening program of doing pyrometry. Now, then the next most important thing is for lung resection surgeries. Say we are doing a lobectomy or a pneumonectomy where we are going to remove part of the lung. We assess the lung function to calculate the predicted post-op lung function. Now, post-surgery, after removal of, say, n number of lobes, we can assess what will be the lung function of the patient. And based on that, we can suggest this many lobes can be removed and this many lobes cannot be removed, depending on the post-op lung function. Finally, this is used as a scaring tool. You can do a spirometry, and if the spirometry shows low values, you can scare a patient into quitting smoking. Now, these are the indications. Now, how do you do this test? How do you do the test? Now, we have absolute criteria and relative criteria. In absolute criteria, we have acceptability factor. Acceptability factor is basically there should be a sharp takeoff in spirometry, there should be no hesitation, and the extrapolated volume, that is the start volume, should be less than 0.15 liter. That is the target. The start volume, that is the extrapolated volume, should be less than 150 ml. Now, end of test criteria should also be met. Complete exhalation to residual volume should be there. Plateau on volume time curve. Plateau on volume time curve and exhalation time of more than 6 seconds. That is, the patient starts blowing and keeps blowing till he reaches his residual volume. The moment he reaches his residual volume, there will be a plateau in the volume time curve. You stop at that particular time. Generally, it is approximately 6 seconds for anybody. Now, there should not be any artifacts. Artifacts are measure or exhalation measures that are done by a patient to cause disturbance in the PFPs. Artifacts such as cough, glottis closure, hesitation or submaximal effort, air leak, and obstruction of mouthpiece. These are all various factors that we need to consider, making sure they are absent in your flow volume loop before we take up spirometry for assessment. This is the acceptability criteria. The next is repeatability criteria. What do you mean by repeatability criteria is very simple. The two largest FVCs should be less than 150 ml of each other. The two largest FVCs, that is post vital capacity, should be less than 150 ml of each other. And the two largest post expiratory volume in the first second should be less than 150 ml of each other. This is the repeatability criteria. Now you have the acceptability criteria and the repeatability criteria. Both these criteria have to be met in a flow volume loop to have a acceptable standard maneuver of spirometry. Now, what do you mean by that? Sorry, 1 second, the screen is frozen. So this is the flow volume time loop. Now this is what is commonly seen in spirometry. You can see the cursor. When the patient starts exhaling, it rises sharply and then slowly tapers down as the patient exhales to a time of 6 seconds and then inhales again. Now this is the flow. X-axis has the flow and the y-axis has the volume in it. Okay, now as the patient has increases flow and blows out according to time, you have the flow volume loop. Now this is called the time volume loop. These two volume loops will be seen in any spirometry that you do. This is the volume time curve. The volume time curve is basically the x-axis as the volume and the y-axis as the time. As the patient starts blowing, it will increase drastically. At the first second is the post-expiratory volume in the first second. At the second, it's the second mark is the 2 second mark. It is the forced expiratory volume is the second 2 second mark. Then similarly, forced expiratory volume is the 3 second mark. Forced expiratory volume is the 4, 5, and 6 second mark. This is the flow volume time loop. The volume time loop should rise sharply and gradually plateau out, as you saw in the acceptability maneuver. These two factors are what we see in an acceptability maneuver. Repeatability, we keep asking the patient to do the same volume loop again and again and again. And if the same volume loop has the same size and the volume difference is less than 150 ml, we take it as repeatable. Some of the abbreviations that you will be seeing from now on in a spirometry: post expiratory volume in the first second of is FEV1, that is the amount of air that the patient expels in the first second. Post vital capacity, the total amount of air that the patient is able to blow out in a 6 second maneuver. Post expiratory volume in the post expiratory flow in the 25th percentile to the 75th percentile, that's basically middle of the expiration, starting at the 25th percentile of expiration till the 75th percentile of expiration. That's called FEF 25-75. TLC is going to be total lung capacity, as in the total capacity of your lungs. Functional residual capacity, the amount of air that is going to take part in gaseous exchange, is otherwise known as functional residual capacity. Then you have your residual volume, your diffusion capacity for carbon monoxide, otherwise known as diffusion capacity or transfer factor, DLCO. Alveolar volume is going to be mentioned as VA. And finally, DLCO by VA. These are some of the abbreviations that we are going to be discussing going forward. So I want you to all get familiar with these abbreviations. Yeah, assessment. Now, this is when you start interpreting the spirometry. Now you have seen if the volume loop is acceptable. You have seen whether the volume loop, time volume loop, is repeatable. Now you have had the acceptability criteria, you have met the acceptability criteria, now you have met the reversibility criteria, repeatability criteria. Now you will go for the interpretation. How do you interpret? First, look at the time volume loop. Are you happy with the shape of the size of the time volume loop? Look at the flow volume loop. Are you happy with the size and shape of the flow volume loop? If you are happy with it, go for the interpretation of the values. The first and foremost value that you will see is post expiratory volume in the first second divided by post vital capacity, otherwise known as FEV1 by FVC. You look at that value, and if it is less than the fifth percentile of normal, then you know that there is obstruction. Simply put, a value of FEV1 by FVC less than 70 is the fifth percentile in normal value. A value of less than 70 generally indicates the presence of obstruction. If the FEV1 by FVC is above this fifth percentile, then it can be normal or it can indicate restriction. I will explain further into what is that when we start doing the exercises. Now, as I said, FEV1 by FVC less than the fifth percentile or an absolute value of 70 is going to be taken as obstruction. A value of more than the fifth percentile or a value of above 70, you're going to take as normal or maybe restriction, depending on other parameters studied in spirometry. The next thing that we assess is bronchodilator reversibility. We'll go into that. What is bronchodilator reversibility? Generally, after we do the PFT, we give a bronchodilator. We use the acetylene or salbutamol or levosalbutamol. The drug is given a 100 microgram dosage of salbutamol or an 18 microgram dosage of levosalbutamol is given. After we give the dosage, we wait for 20 minutes for the drug to act. After that, we repeat the spirometry. Now, when we repeat the spirometry, we assess the lung function values again. We see the FEV1 value again, and we see the FVC value again. Based on that, we go for the bronchodilator reversibility. Bronchodilator reversibility has matured, and our understanding has changed over the past. From 1974 to 2010, we have been having various criteria, but now We follow GOLD guidelines, Global Initiative for Obstructive Lung Diseases, otherwise known as GOLD. GOLD is an international organization which basically monitors and treats obstructive airway diseases. Now, members of GOLD have come up with the final classification of FEV1 more than 12% change, a 12% change from the value obtained in the first and the second, or more than 200 ml and more than 200 ml increase in the FEV1 absolute value is taken as bronchodilator reversible. Now, so as I said, you have identified obstruction. The FEV1 by FVC value is less than the 5th percentile, otherwise less than 70. You have identified there is obstruction. Now it's time to grade the obstruction, whether it is mild, whether it is moderate, or whether it is severe, very severe, depending on the forced expiratory volume in the first second FEV1 value. We will calculate mild, moderate, severe, and very severe obstruction. Now, in mild obstruction, you will have an FEV1 value in the percentage of 70 to 100. In the moderate obstruction, you will have an FEV1 value in the region of 60 to 70%. In moderately severe or severe obstruction, you will have a value between 34 to 60%. And in very severe obstruction, you will have a value of less than 34%. It's very simple to grade it. You just need to mug it up. You should have it in memory. Depending on the FEV1 value, we will put a grade on their obstruction. It can be either mild, moderate, severe, or very severe. This is the GOLD classification based on FEV1 as I said, it's mild obstruction when it's 80 to 100, moderate obstruction when 50 to 80, severe obstruction when it is 30 to 450, and less than 30, it is very severe obstruction. You will see that there is a difference between the assessment grade level of ATS guidelines and GOLD guidelines. You can follow either, but as I said, from 2010, we are only following GOLD guidelines. We are not following any other guidelines. So you all have to follow GOLD guidelines. So your FEV1 criteria for identifying moderate, mild, moderate, severe, and very severe, this is the values that you need to take in mind. Everybody, whoever is all the respiratory therapy students, whoever is attending this class, please take a photo of the slide or print screen the slide and save it so that you can use it for the exercise that is going to come up in the end of the presentation. All my respiratory therapy students will be participating in this question answer session. So, I'm sorry. So, all the respiratory therapy students are going to participate in this. So, all of you, remember this slide. You will have to grade the obstruction and tell me in the end. Right. What are the various pitfalls with spirometry? Now, spirometry is effort related. It is education related. Okay, you can see my slide, ma'am.
Yes, sir, visible now.
Okay, sorry for the delay. Hopefully the current doesn't go again, and or else we have to restart everything again. So I'll try to finish it up fast. So as I said, the doing of spirometry is not without pitfalls. It has a lot of complications, as it is patient effort related and patient education related. Say if the patient is not very the patient is very apprehensive, or he does not understand the maneuvers, he generally tends to do it in a poor fashion, and the poor effort is related as poor FEV1 and FVC values. Now, so that FEV1 and FVC and FEF2575, they're all basically dependent on the patient effort. So it is highly user oriented. So there can be a lot of faults in using it as accurate measurements of lung function. So to avoid that, we use something we call as lung volume studies. Now, what do you mean by lung volume? A lung volume is basically assessing your tidal volume, your inspiratory reserve volume, your expiratory reserve volume, and your residual volume. You're able to assess all the volumes. Based on the volumes, you can assess your capacities of the lung, such as total lung capacity, vital capacity, inspiratory capacity, and functional residual capacity. You can measure the four capacities using the four volumes. This is how we do spirometry for assessing both the capacities and lung volumes. Now, how do you do these tests? There are three methods. We have the nitrogen washout technique, you have the helium dilution technique, and then you have the body plethysmograph. Now, the commonly used one is the nitrogen washout technique, because it's very easy to do. You inhale the nitrogen and you exhale depending on depending on the amount of nitrogen that is coming out. You assess all the lung function and the volumes are calculated. Helium dilution, you give a fixed concentration of helium. The helium comes out completely. Sit inside a vacuum box.
Sir, you're not
on. Diseases are basically diseases of the airways, upper airways and lower airways, not the parenchyma, pleura, or the interstitium. Now, there are other three important parts of the lung which we cannot assess the function based on only spirometry. So, you need lung volume studies. What are these other diseases? What if one is obstruction? We know airway diseases cause obstruction. The parenchymal and the interstitial lung diseases are going to cause something called as restriction, as in restriction to flow of air. If it's in the airway causes obstruction of flow of air. If the lungs are not functioning well, there is restriction to flow of air. How do you grade this restriction? Depending on the value of your total lung capacity, calculated by doing all these measures, we will assess the severity of restriction. You can have mild restriction if it is 70 to 80%, moderate restriction if it's 60 to 70%, and less than 60% you go for directly severe restriction. Yeah. Now, the pitfalls of doing an FVC related measurement of restriction is, you know, it is effort related, so we don't use that. We use TLC, total lung capacity, which is more accurate. Now, there are conditions which are going to cause hyperinflation of the lungs, such as bronchial asthma, COPD. Now, these kind of diseases will cause hyperinflation of the lungs. Hyperinflation of the lungs will cause an increase in FRC, which will show an elevated total lung capacity, even though that the lung capacity is on the lower side. Now, similarly, there can be air trapping in various diseases, which can result in increased residual volume, even though the residual volume is inaccurately measured based on lung volume. So these are the pitfalls with dealing with lung volume studies. Now, the next most important thing that we do is the DLCO. DLCO in the simplest sense is basically studying the diffusing capacity, basically that is the transfer factor, the ability of a gas to cross from air through the interstitium and mix into the blood. Now, we use carbon monoxide for this because all of you know carbon monoxide has the highest affinity for association with hemoglobin when you compare with oxygen. Carbon monoxide readily attaches itself to the hemoglobin compared to carbon monoxide attaches itself to the hemoglobin compared to oxygen. So we use carbon monoxide depending on the absorption of carbon monoxide from the, and the amount of carbon monoxide coming out in the exhaled air, we calculate the diffusion capacity. Using the diffusion capacity, we can identify the lung functioning assessment. Okay, the other is known as LFA. Based on the LFA, we can assess the progression of a disease, we can monitor the response of therapy, and we can assess the improvement in general physical condition. Now, we can also calculate the alveolar volume, otherwise known as VA. DLCO by VA is an important prognosticate marker. DLCO by VA, if it's on the lower side, we know that the patient is going to have high chance of morbidity and mortality. Now, the pitfall with DLCO is, if the patient has low hemoglobin, say the patient's hemoglobin value is only 8.4, the DLCO is going to come back low. The DLCO coming back low is not because of lung, there is problems in the lungs, but it is because of low hemoglobin value. So lower the value of hemoglobin, lower the value of DLCO. So that does not indicate a low lung functioning capacity. You have to assess that before we do a DLCO for a patient. Now, similarly, as I said, DLCO by VA is useful for a prognostication. So if DLCO by VA is on the lower side, you know for a fact that the prognosis is going to be poor. Right. Next. As I said, the next most important thing that we do is body box plethysmograph. It's an alternative means of measuring the lung function. The patient sits in a closed box. So based on that, the patient inhales and exhales and does various respiratory maneuvers. Based on the amount of air displaced from the box, we calculate the lung volumes. Similarly, airway resistance can also be measured in this. Airway resistance is very useful when we are dealing with upper airway diseases. Now, finally, as I said, we can all use various other methods for assessing the lung function, even though they are not as such assessing the lung function, such as the VQ scans, the 6-minute walk test, the cardiopulmonary exercise testing, and the arterial blood gas analysis. They're basically all physiological measures which we can use to assess the lung function. Say for example, when you want to know there is hypoxemia due to a pulmonary shunt, you will do an arterial blood gas analysis where you will be able to assess the partial pressure of oxygen in the arterial blood. Depending on the value of less than 60, you know that whether there is hypoxia. Let's go to the next. How do you report a pulmonary function test and how do you interpret it? Now, when you start, you write the date of the test, the day the test was done. Now, then you start evaluating. The spirometry shows post vital capacity with severely reduced to 49% of the predicted value. FEV1 reduced to 32%. FEV1 by FVC is 66%. FEF 2575. Basically, you start writing all the values. Now, after you do a DLCO and a lung volume, you say the total lung capacity was identified as 63% of predicted. The diffusion capacity was reduced to 37% of predicted. Now, depending on all these values, you make a diagnosis of severe obstructive defect with very mild response to bronchodilators, severe air trapping. You have severe air trapping, severe diffusion impairment, and other condition based on the clinical assessment. Now, before you report again, make sure your acceptability criteria is met, your repeatability criteria is met, your tidal volume is seen, your functional vital capacity is measured, it's adequate. Is there presence of obstruction or not? After obstruction, you assess the grade. 1, 2, 3, 4, whether it is severe, mild, moderate, or very severe, then possible restriction, yes or no, and add your other comments in your reporting. Thank you. Before I go on to the next, all my respiratory therapy students, unmute yourself, please. My respiratory therapy students, all of you are there. So who shall we start with? Dinesh, select one. Tell me a respiratory therapy.
Kirtiga.
We'll start with Kirtiga. Kirtiga is there in the class?
Yes, sir.
Ah, hello, Kirtiga. Now, Kirtiga, you can see my slide, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is your case one. Yeah, case one. A 60-year-old man who has 60-pack-year smoking history. Dyspnea on exertion. You know your ABG is showing a PO2 of only 56. Now we have FVC value of 73%, FEV1 of 23%, FEV1 by FVC is only 25, FEF 25-75 is... Why did he sign out? Hey, you can see me still, Kirtika?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Sorry, something else came up, so I just got confused. Your TLC of 9.7 liters, or otherwise known as 150%. Your DLCO by VA is only 19%. Now, report this, Kirtika. Tell me the report. Hello, you can hear me?
Ah, yes, sir.
Yeah, you want to try reporting it? I'll help you. Don't worry.
Okay, sir.
I'll help you with it.
Okay.
Right. What is the FEV1, FVC value, Kirtika?
73%.
So, 73%. What is the FEV1 value?
23%.
Now, you know for a fact your FVC value is very high, your FEV1 value is very low. Okay, so your FEV1 by FVC is going to be less than 70 or more than 70?
More than 70.
How come? FEV1 is only 23. FVC is 73.
Okay.
23 divided by 73. How will it be high? What will be the number? Kirtika?
Yes, sir.
23 by 73, ma. Enna number varu? என்ன நம்பர் வரும் வெரி குட் மேக்ஸே போட்ட போல வெரி குட் 0.31 தானே வருது அப்ப இட் இஸ் லெஸ் தென் 70 ரைட்
சார் எஸ் சார்
சோ இட் இஸ் அப்ஸ்ட்ரக்ஷன் Okay.
Yes.
Now grade the obstruction.
Stage 4, so very severe.
Huh?
Very severe.
Very severe obstruction. Very good. Now, see his total lung capacity. How much is his TLC?
The slide is not visible, sir.
Slide is not visible. One second, ma. Sorry, ma. I think something happened with my Google Meet again. Yeah. Keeps happening. I'm really sorry. Yeah. You can see my slide now?
No, sir.
Yeah, yeah. What is the TLC, total lung capacity value, ma?
TLC.
150%. 9.7 liters, 150%. Okay. Now, is 150% normal or super normal? Kirtika, normal?
Super normal. Super normal, sir. Wait,
super normal. 100. Why will a patient who's a smoker will have a super normal finding in TLC? Because he has hyperinflation. I told no. When there is hyperinflation, you will have increased total lung capacity. So that is what is happening. You are able to identify there is hyperinflation. Now, DLCO by alveolar volume, how much is it?
19%.
19%. 80% ke keela irundha enna artham? DLCO by VA, 80% keela irundha?
Diffusion capacity.
Poor nu artham. Restriction irukku artham. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Got it?
Yes, sir.
Right. So the answer will be this patient has emphysema. FEV1 by FEC is less than 70, so indicates obstruction. FEV1 is less than 34%, which indicates very severe obstruction. Total lung capacity is elevated, diffusion capacity very low. Okay. So for this, there is non-reversible obstruction, elevated lung volumes, low diffusing capacity. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, Kirtika. You can mute yourself now. We are going to unmute somebody else next. Yara per solradhu. Harita. Okay. Harita. Harita, you are online? Harita? Ah, yes. I can barely hear you. What is happening to your mic? You can hear me, Harita?
Yes, sir.
Ah, okay, Harita. Start reading. Patient number 2, 50-year-old man, 65 pack years smoking, history of cough. Chest X-ray shows diffuse reticulonodular pattern. Now his FEC is 62%, FEV1 is 42%, FEV1 by FEC is 56%, TLC is 64%, DLCO by VA is 29%. Okay. Now shall we start reporting it?
Yes, sir.
Harita.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, start. So is there obstruction or not? Harita? Obstruction irukka illiyama? Obstruction irukka illiya? FEV1 by FEC evlo irukku paaru?
FEV1 42%.
FEV1 by FEC evlo irukku? 56, correct? 56, right?
Yes, sir. Moderate obstruction, sir.
Ma, you can hear me?
Yes, sir.
56. So 56 is less than 70, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Appo obstruction irukka illaya?
Yes, sir. Moderate obstruction, sir.
Moderate obstruction. Very good, very good. Moderate obstruction. Now, what about the total lung capacity? Total lung capacity is what? 64%. 64% na evlo restriction adu? Mild restriction or moderate restriction?
Mild obstruction, sir.
Illa ma, TLC. Nama obstruction vandutoma, moderate obstruction kandupidichitom. Okay, FEV1 by FEC is less than 70. We know it is obstruction. FEV1 is 42%. We know it is moderate. So we know moderate obstruction is there. Actually, sorry, severe obstruction. 42%, not severe. So 42% FEV1, severe obstruction. We know there is severe obstruction. Now we are looking at the total lung capacity. The total lung capacity is only 64%. Now if the total lung capacity is 64%, it is known that it is less than 80%. Total lung capacity of less than 80% means there is obstruction, the restriction. There is restriction. Now what is the grade of restriction? 70 to 80 is mild restriction, 60 to 70 is moderate restriction, less than 60 is severe restriction. Now what is the value here?
Moderate restriction.
Very good. Moderate restriction. Chale, we'll go see the answer now. Very good, Harita. Very good. Yeah. So the patient, this patient is a bit more complex because he has both obstruction and restriction. Okay. When these type of patients have both obstruction and restriction, you will have a huge differential diagnosis. You can have cystic fibrosis, bronchiectasis, lymphangeal leiomyomatosis, eosinophilic granuloma, interstitial diseases with COPD. There are so many differential diagnoses. For example, this patient basically had an eosinophilic granuloma. Okay, next. Next, who wants to unmute themselves? I want a volunteer from respiratory therapy. Anybody volunteering? Next pair, sir. Next pair name. Okay. So I will discuss this case again so that everybody understands it. Case 3, 36-year-old man with muscular dystrophy is presently wheelchair bound and an arterial blood gas demonstrates PO2 of 60 and a PCO2 of 52. The FVC is 31%, FV1 is 33%, FV1 by FVC is 85%, total lung capacity is 50% and DLCO by VA is 144%. Now, as we discuss this case, you can see this case is a little weird because the FEV1 by FEC is normal, so he's not obstructed, but his TLC is low, that means he's restricted. So diffusion capacity is very high, so there is no impairment in gas transport. So this indicates that the patient has a restrictive lung disease, but not a lung pathology. Now a lung is absolutely normal, but there is something causing restriction to his lung function. So that can be seen in diseases such as kyphoscoliosis, severe ascites, immediate post-cardiac surgery. Okay. Right. I think with this, I will end the session. Thank you. Any questions, any doubts, if you have anybody you want to ask, you can please ask.
Thank you, sir. For an excellent presentation and making this webinar very interesting. Participants, if you have any doubts, you can ask.
Any questions, anybody?
There's no question in the chat box, sir. I think there's no doubt.
Okay, fine. I think we'll end it, ma'am. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the principal of AHS, Dr. Kalpana, for giving us this opportunity to conduct this webinar. I want to thank Dr. Shahnawaz Khan, our medical director, for always being there and supporting us. I want to thank our chancellor and founder, Dr. A.C. Shanmugam, our president and our secretary, sir, for always being there in our support. I also want to thank the vice principal of AHS. Thank you, madam. And I also want to thank my department, respiratory therapists, both Rajesh and Dinesh, for helping me in organizing this webinar. Thank you so much. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our vice principal, ma'am, Dr. Bhavani, to deliver a word of thanks.
Thank you, Nirla ma'am. Good morning to our honorable management committee, chief guest, friends, seniors, and everyone present here. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this webinar. Very first, I thank Almighty for providing us with strength and energy during this pandemic situation. I, on behalf of the Faculty of Allied Health Science Department, and extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our Honorable Chairman, Dr. A.C. Shanmugam, sir, President Engineer A.C.S. Arun Kumar, sir, Secretary Thiru A. Ravikumar, sir, Vice Chancellor, Dr. Geeta Lakshmi, madam, Registrar, Dr. Palanivel, sir, and our Medical Director, Dr. Shahnawaz Khan, sir. They all blessed us with their presence and encouragement. encouraged us to conduct this webinar. I especially liked Dr. Jackin Moser's talk. His webinar was very enthusiastic, where he mentioned about the advanced pulmonary function test. The way he explained the topic is exemplary. Hope everyone might be benefited out of it in spite of the technical fault during this webinar. Thank you, sir. I also wish to express my gratitude to our principal, Dr. V. Kalpana Devi, madam, for providing encouragement and support for this webinar. I'm very grateful to all the faculty members and students for their participation in this webinar from our institution and other institutions. And to conclude, as no program can become successful with a single person, so I extend my big thanks to our faculty of Allied Health Science Department for their support and all our volunteers too. Thank you, friends, for making this event successful with your contribution. Once again, I thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. On behalf of Allied Health Science and the entire fraternity of management, I thank the speaker for all the valuable information he shared with us. Thank you, sir. And I would like to express my deep gratitude to our principal, ma'am, for awakening the passion and desire to us as a ladder to reach the pole of success. Your constant support and encouragement has helped us in the best way. Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, everyone. Stay home, stay safe. And the feedback will be posted in the chat box. You can fill it. Thank you once again.
Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute warmly welcomes you to a world-class educational campus that showcases excellent infrastructure facilities, housing various departments in diverse fields of study. Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute warmly welcomes you to a world-class educational campus that showcases excellent infrastructure facilities, housing various departments in diverse fields of study.
Educational and Research Institute, Madurai, Chennai. Dr. MGR Educational and Research Institute, Madurai, Chennai.